Good afternoon. Hello. Hi. I'm going to keep saying hi. Okay, shh. I'm a librarian too. Shh. I'm allowed to do that, and we're in the library. So, hello to everybody again. Welcome on this totally frozen afternoon. You're brave for going outside and coming here. Welcome to the library. My name is Matt Knutzen. I'm the geospatial librarian in the map division upstairs, the Lionel Pincus and Princess Ferio map division. I'm also the acting curator of the Irma and Paul Milstein division of U.S. history, local history, and genealogy, which is upstairs. So I encourage you to come use our collections and visit our reading rooms. They're beautiful. Collections are awesome. I also happen to be the president of GISMO, or the Geographic Information Systems and Mapping Organization. So I encourage you all to look into GISMO. We've got flyers outside. Sign up. There's some great perks and benefits for joining. So today's program is, of course, co-sponsored by the Map Division and GISMO. Last year, we started to revitalize the organization after a few more of years and try to remake ourselves, really, in the midst of this giant explosion of spatial data and web mapping that's happening. And today we kick off our second season, which is really exciting. And it so happens we enter our 25th year as an organization, which I think is pretty amazing. And it's pretty amazing to think in the context of GIS that this group has been around for 25 years, thanks to this gentleman who will raise his hand right now, Jack Eichenbaum, who was the original ringleader. Thank you, Jack. So I'd like to thank everybody else, including everybody on the board, for making all of this possible, this event, and helping to rebuild this organization. I mean, really, it's all of your energy that's making this happen. This just wouldn't be happening at all without all of you, so thank you. I mean that sincerely, thank you. This is great. Before starting, I want to talk a little bit about GISMO and why we think it's a good organization, why you should join. We were founded in 1990. All sort of with a common understanding that GIS is, of course, among the most powerful components of internet technology because it can organize and integrate and analyze and share spatial data. This is an incredibly important function. So GISMO has been historically one of the New York City metro area's largest GIS organizations. With at one point 700 plus members from all over different city, federal, state agencies, and also within the nonprofit and the private sector. So it's a really broad swath of people, a really great group. So we believe also that the New York City region can be sort of a pivotal point in national center, really, in terms of GIS. Education, GIS use, research and development, job development, because of the extensive efforts to build GIS infrastructure and GIS data for the city, make it really some of the best for any urban place around. And because of the regional strength in terms of IT, telecommunications infrastructure, and private sector work going on. So GISMO provides a really valuable forum to share a lot of data about all of this, both well-established practices, emerging practices, new technology that's coming along, news, publications about geographic information, meetings like this. It gives vendors an opportunity to share information about jobs, internships, opportunities, software training, all this kind of stuff. This is a great forum to share all of that. So, as you might guess, and as I've been sort of alluding to, one of GISMO's primary purposes is networking. This is a network. This is a community of people. So more specifically, networking to advance GIS in the New York City region, bringing all of us together. We're the part of this community. you know, government at all levels, universities, libraries, people running public utilities, and on, students, interested citizens, the public, and so on and so forth. So Gizmo has served this purpose for many years, helping to build out NYC's enterprise GIS and helping to organize and coordinate the 9/11 GIS efforts. So we'll also continue to host events like this throughout the year to bring the community together. So one more note on networking. Join us all after this. We're going to have a hard stop at about 5:50, at which point everybody here is going to go over to 40th. At 40 West 40th, and join us at the cellar bar between 5th and 6th. Is it 40 West 40th? Yeah. Sorry, 40 West 40th. You'll have a warm drink over at the cellar bar at the Bryant Park Hotel with all of us. It'll be great. So, to continue on. But of course, we need to, everybody who shares this vision, we hope that you would join us, of course. And, you know, you see the annual fee is $20, which is not very much, and you also get a membership to the State GIS Association. And students are free. We're sponsoring student memberships for free, so if you're a student, please join us. It'd be great. So again, this is our 25th anniversary, and we're going to be organizing a celebration in May around that. It's going to be fantastic. We hope that you can join us for that, too. Okay, so turning to today for a moment, we're going to hear from a whole bunch of folks from across the community who are going to talk in four rounds of lightning talks today about geographic information from the perspective of both data users and data providers. We'll have four rounds. The first one, we'll have Jordan Preston from LavaMap, Alicia Ronald from LocalData, David Fine from Placemeter, Leo Bonani from Sourcemap. In our second round, we'll have Miguel Arias from CartoDB. We'll have Joshua Campbell from Boundless. In our third round, we'll have Joel Navidad from Ontodia, Rachel Law from Interface Foundry, Bianca Rodriguez from Liquid Galaxy. And then we're going to follow with a lightning round and a discussion around data from data providers, including myself, being a library person promoting data on the web, GIS data on the web. OGP's Chris Barnett from New York City DoITT. We'll have Colin Reilly from Westchester County, Sam Weir, and New York State ITS, Andrew Nicklin. So we're going to get those started up, and we're going to kick off the round with Jordan. So let's get these slides going. Let's see, maybe I need a hand here. Jesse. All of a sudden, I'm like, okay, what button do I push? Okay. Welcome, Jordan, to the stage, okay?
Hi. So a little history about myself. About 10 years ago, I was a sophomore at Pratt. I was studying architecture and always had an interest in real estate development and urban planning. And I started working as an intern at a large commercial brokerage. And I noticed that the business was highly fragmented and there was a lot of information going everywhere. And I didn't know how to manage all the information. I was working with the COO of the company, and I remember his desk being overloaded with papers. It reminds me of my grandfather's desk, which was also in real estate. And I realized that buildings produce a lot of data, and that there's no one way to manage your data. The real estate industry, I feel like, has really been left behind. So I continued my education at Pratt, and I obtained a bachelor's of architecture, and I went on to work at a large real estate search engine, PropertyShark.com, a director of professional services. And I noticed that they had something, but they didn't have everything. So I figured there was a better way to simplify all the information. So I said, let's put it all on one map and let's let people own their data. Let's let people research properties for free. Let's let people post listings, and let's try and build a community. So it took me about 10 years, I'm still in beta, but I finally got into an interface which works. So this is sort of just a quick image, but the idea is that you can zoom in on any single property in New York City, and you can find out who owns it, the taxpayers, and call them directly.
Thank you.
Obtain comparable sales information and other listing data all from one centralized location. There's almost 8.5 million people in the city. About 10% are property owners, and there's about 50,000 people servicing over 125,000 listings, and they're all over the place. So I think that there's definitely an opportunity. We're playing with different ways to monetize the service at this point, and we think that we could definitely provide information to property owners based on their interests, based on where their building's located, and for a small subscription, could probably generate a lot of money. So key points were free to research any property in New York City, mobile friendly, and allow you to save your data. We came up with a unique marketing campaign, sort of where we started and what's currently available on our website. And it's a physical sign that you place on a building when it becomes available for lease or sale. It has unique code. One who passes by can call or text message the phone number 212 LavaMap, enter the unique ID, and obtain the information immediately. Conversely, if you are managing that store, you get a notification about the property, so or about the person acquiring the property. So we feel that this could be a way to sort of visually brand the platform and sort of push it out. We'll probably talk a little bit more about technology and whatnot.
Check us
Hi, my name is Alicia Rouleau. I'm the CEO and founder of a company called LocalData. So we know that cities are changing quite quickly these days, and we have more data than ever before. And we have it about ourselves, and even now about our homes. We're approaching a time where we're going to have more data than ever before about the places that we live in. So we think back to those cities that are changing, and the decisions that go into how those changes are made, they don't always use that newly available information. So we're a company that's based in New York and San Francisco. And so if we go back to where I just flew out of San Fran, there's a huge Warriors development. This is a big stadium project. It was proposed, it was a $500 million development, and it was shut down due to a single ballot vote. A lot of money was lost in this deal. And the reason why was that there were assumptions made in a data vacuum. You had residents on the one hand who were very concerned about what was going to happen to their neighborhood. And then on the other hand, you had real estate developers who were excited about the opportunity, but didn't do the due diligence to truly understand that local context. So if we fast forward to today, they've purchased a new site at Mission Bay, which is just along the waterfront from the original site. And the person responsible for making sure that the mistakes don't happen of the original project is a guy named Casey. He's an urban planner, and he's an analyst that works in a real estate firm. He needs to use data to make some very important decisions. He tries to look at existing conditions, how people move around, how are they going to get to that stadium to make it a success. And he actually sends out teams of data collectors to gather information. He does that using pen and paper, clickers to count things like bicycles and pedestrians. And then he has this tough data mining problem. He scours the internet for hours upon hours looking for census data, for proprietary data, going to places like data.gov, geospatial sometimes, not always, and it takes forever. And this isn't just his problem, this is anyone that works with data. The New York Times reported spends 50 to 80% of their time actually cleaning it, collecting it, and preparing it before they can actually do that analysis. And that's just conventionally available data. There's also incredible amounts of information that our cell phones in our pockets, sensor networks, and new sensors are collecting about things like air quality. Social media tells us the pulse of the city, real-time traffic conditions. But if you're not a programmer, and even if you're just a GIS expert, you're sometimes met with a script. And certainly professionals like Casey see this and shy away. So we have two problems. We have disparate, bulky government data, and that the best possible new data is simply inaccessible to most professionals. We've created local data as a place to aggregate urban information, to first create new data sets, explore it using a map, that's not the end point, and then export it either through an API or through a raw data download to do analysis. This is our current existing solution. We created a platform to augment and create new geospatial data using existing administrative data sets like parcel data, sidewalk lines, and street lines, or even points, analyze and share in the browser very quickly. Again, collecting information on infrastructure or people, all in real time. And then from there, bring it into a single dashboard where you can draw lines on a map to constrain the point of data that you want to look at to the site that matters to you, bring in that real-time information that's collected in the field, view it over time, bring in things like traffic congestion data that can tell us about where cars are in the city, and even things like Instagram that can be used to understand where people go and why they go there. From there, you can view it in tabular form and ultimately export it for your analysis. Casey then has the best data and the easiest workflow, and it makes his project a success. So we're helping urban leaders make data-driven decisions in government, in research at universities, and with design. And we've launched in 30 cities to tackle tough problems from supply chain management to vacant property to economic development to real estate. We believe that better data makes better cities and that everyone should be able to use it. So find out more, localdata.com. Thanks.
My name is David Fine. I'm a product manager at Placemeter. What we're doing is we're indexing the real world in real time. What does that actually mean? So this is a video of Times Square. It's provided by a company called EarthCam, which puts up little videos, live streams for tourists who are interested in points of interest throughout major urban cities throughout the world. So I'm not entirely sure who's going to the live stream of Times Square, but they have it on their website. Basically, what Placemeter does is takes this live stream of a very heavily trafficked streets and intersection, and it turns it into real data. So while we see this, Placemeter sees this. And what we're doing is we're building computer vision algorithms that automatically detect and measure things like how many people are walking on a sidewalk, how fast and how many cars are streaming down the street, how many people are walking in and out of a store. What we do is we collect all of this data, store it in a centralized database, and then push it out in whichever way people want to consume it. So we consume not just this video stream from EarthCam, but a variety of video streams. There are public, sorry. There are public video streams. Is it playing again? So there are public video streams, like Earth Campus video streams. There are streams from the Department of Transportation and other public city cameras that we ingest, and then there are private streams from clients. In addition, we also crowdsource video streams. So we have a program in New York where we pay people up to $50 a month to put this on their window. So it's an old Android or iPhone. And looks like the slides got mixed up, but important privacy rules that we built our system around. We don't look at videos as much as we can, aside from occasional QA purposes. We don't create a video archive. We don't record videos, except for less than 0.01% that we need, again, for quality assurance purposes. And we don't build algorithms or use data that would identify people individually. We're not here to track individuals. We're here to generate aggregate level traffic data for pedestrian and traffic and car and vehicular traffic patterns throughout cities. So as I said, we ingest this data and then we export it in something that's consumable. So we're just now, today, really in New York City. And so we're processing in real time a variety of different video streams and exporting the data to customers and people who care about it. So today we're covering over 250 locations in the city, and we're measuring over 8 million events every single day on average. Tomorrow we want to be worldwide, starting with the United States, but then elsewhere. And we really want to become this living, breathing data layer for you to understand how cities operate and how people use them. So we're just now extrapolating a variety of different use cases for this sort of data, but I'll run you through a couple. So there's the smart city use case, which I know is relatively vague, but take the example of Casey. Casey is sitting out there with his manual counters writing down pedestrian traffic patterns. He could use Placemeter's data to do that for him. And then use local data to process it. you can identify where there's pedestrian traffic congestion throughout city, or where there are a higher likelihood of near misses for vehicles hitting pedestrians. There's retail site selection, so stores that want to understand where best to place their new location could use our data to better understand pedestrian traffic in different neighborhoods. And then there's retail operations. Once you find the correct store, see how many people are actually walking in front of the store, looking in, and deciding to bounce. It's something that websites track all the time, but stores have a very difficult time tracking. And there are a variety of different other applications. We think that we've only touched the tip of the iceberg of various GIS and commercial applications that and also civic applications that our service can provide. So afterwards, I'd be happy to talk to anybody who's interested. We're also hiring, so check out our site at placemeter.com/jobs. Thank you.
Neil Banani from Sourcemap.
Good afternoon.
Okay.
All right, so this is going to be not an urban story, but a global one, but I think you'll all know how it touches cities. So who recognizes this picture? Not many people. Okay, so the Rana Plaza factory collapse in 2012 is the biggest industrial disaster of the last 10 years. 1,000 people died in Bangladesh. And it took a couple of weeks for the brands that use that manufacturing facility to discover that they were actually using that manufacturing facility. And it's been taking 2 years since then to try to fix things down there. Why does this happen? And believe it or not, there's a GIS solution. This is because a supply chain looks a little bit like this. When globalization started in the 70s and 80s, there really wasn't the software to manage all the relationships it takes to make a product, especially when you're talking about food or apparel, where there's often hundreds of thousands of companies contracting together to get you the things you buy every day. So with the advent of crowd mapping, web mapping, with the advent of social media and social networking, it's a piece of cake now to communicate with hundreds of millions of people around the world in real time. but not when Rana Plaza was contracted by the brands around the world to make clothes. So guess which slide is from my product deck. We discovered that, you know, it wasn't corporate malfeasance, it wasn't some sort of evil plot. Companies really have no idea where their own products come from. In many cases, cities have no idea where products come from that flow through cities, and neither do countries. And so we ended up discovering that you need to put supply chain data in a GIS system. So you need to put a GPS coordinate next to everybody you do business with, whether it's a customer downstream or whether it's a supplier or a supplier's supplier. And then you need to connect all of these things. So I can say the butterfly flaps its wings. The Rana Plaza was kind of the butterfly that unraveled a few hundred companies' supply chains. Right? They realized, what does this sweatshop in Bangladesh have to do with me? I only contract with Chinese companies. Well, no. Your subcontractor actually did business with Rana Plaza, and you are now caught up in the storm. And so tracing means basically taking all those dots on the map, but actually connecting them so that you can create accountability. Follow the money one way, follow the goods the other way. And then you can imagine the potential, right? If you've never seen how goods flow, then you have never seen the risks, you've never listened for the right news, and you've never been able to optimize and improve the design of a supply chain. And that's what we help companies and cities with today. It's basically map their supply chains, figure out what the biggest risks are. When Sandy struck New York City, the biggest supply chain to fail was oil, petroleum, that's right. 9 days without petroleum, we consume about 500,000 barrels a day in this city. 9 days is a long time. And so that's what we do. I'll show you now the really exciting part is, right, it's not just about responding a little bit faster when 1,000 people get crushed to death in a sweatshop. It's actually about preventing these things, knowing that when we invest in our supply chains, even those things that we aren't directly accountable for, we will see benefits down the road, whether that means cheaper or faster or higher quality or more just for the world. I'll show you one of the things we're doing right now in, not at all in New York City, in the rainforest in Brazil. If you buy a product from the rainforest and you want to know that it doesn't cause deforestation, how would you know? You wouldn't. But now there's a system in place using Sourcemap, using mobile tablets, where every good you buy, these could be cosmetics, these could be foods, these could be clothes, that's sourced from these communities is traced. So one thing is you can scan it on the store shelf and find out exactly where it comes from. That's all fine and dandy, and that actually exists in some industries. But now how do you know that's actually fixing anything? You actually see the deforestation in the Amazon if you just pan around in Google Earth. But lately we have these great things called satellites. They're actually measuring deforestation every day. And so you can actually see that those communities where you buy things have greater or lesser deforestation than the other ones. And with that, you'll have to trust me on the deforestation layer because it's going to take a second to show up. There is fixing the world one conscious consumer purchase at a time. And if you want to work with us, or you want us to work with you, leo@sourcemap.com. Thank you.
Before starting. First, for my accent, I come from Spain, so I hope you can understand me. Second, I'm not a GIS expert. I studied civil engineering at the time, so I was just working on the field, nothing to do with GIS or no web mapping, no websites for the matter. So, but since I joined CartoDB 1 year ago, you can see which kind of maps I can create myself in 5 minutes. So I did this over the weekend using amazing data from the New York City, and I could just map easily by zip codes, the percentage of people who are not speaking English very well. I should be there somewhere. So you see some neighborhoods where actually it's pretty amazing how many people do not speak English very well. I could also map my LinkedIn connections and see how I'm connected outside and how this relates to my professional life. And this weekend we had an eco hack at the office, so I could join with other guys from the community and really map where some amazing dolphins and sea turtles were really moving around the United States for a few years. And these kind of things are just being made through CartoDB. We are an online mapping platform to help you understand your data, create online mappings, and gather insights from what's going on. And this is just for non-technical people and for GIS experts. We open and democratize access to mapping to everyone. You can do much more complex things, I would say. That's why I can use a non-technical person, but you could, at the same time, map using the Yelp API. World tourists and locals are actually doing reviews in Vegas, and you see that they're mostly in the stripe of the tourists. You could use as many of our media customers use us to actually create and tell interactive stories based on maps, because when you are a data journalist, the data actually helps you a lot to make people understand what's going on, because maps, as we know, convey perfectly well complex data sets. And you can see how Twitter uses us to actually map the pools of the world. You see here the ancient Indian elections, which go crazy when everybody in India is tweeting about that. You can see how the world gets crazy when Robert Downey Jr. does his first tweet. Okay.
Yeah.
Actually, it's not that he cares much about that, actually, just spent a life on him. But the world was very interested to understand how things evolve in, over the time. So, can GIS, as we know it, move into the web? We do think it can. As our CEO put it recently, we think the future of GIO is not one single app with hundreds of buttons, as we are used to. The future of GIO is hundreds of apps with one single button. I think we have seen here great examples of exactly this. Niche applications solving needs for particular users. We have some of the guys who presented here using CartoDB. I hope that after the videos, everybody will use CartoDB. So I will try to convince you. But you can see here an app created to just map trees in the city of Melbourne, which you can even email a tree for the city, saying that the tree is maybe not sound enough. You can see another app created for real estate in London, where you can actually map all the different kind of open data sources of the city of London and decide and see which neighborhoods have more violent crime rate, which neighborhood has a higher pricing. So you can really create these really great apps by developers using CartoDB as a platform using our open APIs. So the key thing here for us is to create an ecosystem and to build a community. How do we do that? We offer a lot of resources for people to learn how to use CartoDB, how to use our APIs and create amazing apps based on us, and also how to create maps that mean something and are insightful. We offer unlimited resources for academia, so many universities are teaching CartoDB right now. And we just offer now unlimited map views for everybody, not just for our academic users. And we have a network of partners that if any of you would like to join. We have a lot of projects going on right now, so we would love to just be able to divert all of these to our network of partners. And I would just like to invite you to our Cato Mixer in December 11th. We have our offices here in Williamsburg, so in December 11th at 6:30, I hope you join these guys at the office. It's not always that dark, that was yesterday night. So we were very happy to have you join us, join the community, and do maps with us. So thank you so much for your time.
From Boundless, Joshua Campbell. Jump to the punchline. Hi, my name is Joshua Campbell, product manager at Boundless, and I'm here to tell you that spatial data has a problem. Some of you will know that about Boundless, we're a spatial IT company. Primarily, our major product line has been historically the Open Geo Suite. I'm here to tell you a little bit about the new stuff. So, let's talk about spatial data and what its problem is. Anybody who's worked with data for a long time knows that spatial data is difficult to manage. It's hard to keep up to date. It's hard to understand its lineage. And the difficulty of managing all that data scales exponentially when more people are working on the data. So here's the other problem. Spatial data is a Web 2.0 orphan. The rest of the IT world and the social revolution that has impacted all the rest of the industries that we interoperate with has not affected spatial data. And why is that? essentially there's no effective architecture of participation to enable that social element related to spatial data. So that means that data has been locked in a Web 1.0 world, primarily a one-way publishing model of static data catalogs and spatial data infrastructure. So is there a way that we can bring an architecture of participation to spatial data? So we started to look at other solutions. Distributed version control systems. So here's another thing. Software code is difficult to manage. It's difficult to keep up to date. And it's important to understand its lineage. And the problems scale exponentially the number of people that are working on it. So there's a lot of similarities here. So we know primarily from Git that Git was developed by open source code developers working in a network-enabled world. So can we bring that same kind of collaboration into spatial data? So here's kind of the model. At the bottom, you've got the underlying library called Git, which provides the functions for distributed versioning. But on top of that sits GitHub, which is a web tier that, provides access to the repositories and the functions in a way that make it much more usable. So Boundless helped create GeoGate, inspired by Git. But unfortunately, Git as it's written does not work well with complex spatial data types. So we took the verbs and the actions and the notions of Git and rewrote it into an engine that can deal with spatial data. So what does that mean for GIS people who have never, who don't write software code, like myself? It means that you have to learn a new lexicon, things like repository, forking, branching, merging, commit messages. And this idea of a repo of data with a full lineage of history and the commit messages telling you what changed at each difference, who made them, and when did they make it. Very, very powerful stuff. And so the new thing I want to talk about is Verzio. This is our analogy to the GitHub model. Verzio sits on top of GeoGate. You can find it online at vers.io. We're just going into private beta now. So what can you do with Verzio? Well, first, you have to have an editing client. So right now, the editing all occurs inside of QGIS, and you connect to Verzio via a plug-in architecture that allows you to communicate with your remote holdings. ArcMap, mobile, and web editing directly in the browser are all under development. So what can you do? Well, you can, sorry, did a little grain. You can add a new repository. You can set it to private or public. You can add collaborators. Once you load the data in, you can visualize your repository, see how many layers, how many features, what activity has occurred on it recently, how many branches are there. You can come in and look at the commit log. This is the power right here. Every change, what the change was, who made it, when they do it, visualize those changes, compare the changes between any two versions. You can compare them geographically using like a tool, like a slide tool to compare any two versions, or attribute-wise, if the data just changes in the table. So now let's apply this real quickly to a municipal situation. You've got a government who has an open data mandate, who wants to publish data to get citizen engagement. They spend a lot of data, or a lot of time and effort curating that data, and they need to open it. Citizens are willing to help, but it's very difficult for citizens to, for municipalities to incorporate those changes. And you need to track the lineage of provenance. So let's look at what a Verzio workflow would be. Authoritative data set is ingested into a staging repo that's then pushed into a Verzio repo, at which point citizens can come in and branch the data and make edits for themselves, perhaps multiple edits, and then push those branches back up to the Verzio repo. At the same time, the business of government doesn't slow down. The data set, the authoritative data set, is being added to, vetted in their quality control processes, and it's evolving over time. Ultimately, you bring those two things together, merge the differences, and there you go. And this entire commit history and chain persists with the data. It's not a static snapshot of just the terminal endpoint. So with that, again, private beta here, and I'm Josh Campbell, Spatial Data Has a Problem. Thank you.
Okay, up next, Joel Matuda from Ontodia.
Co-founder of Ontodia, and I'm here to talk about your data open data service. So for the first time in 2008, more than half of the total of the population lived in cities, moving from the countryside, which is a great thing, right? Because dense urban living enables all kinds of things, like public transportation, sharing economy, municipal Wi-Fi, and all that things. And with all these open data and big data techniques, people say, hey, you know, what? Now we can apply these big data techniques and get some, a lot of insights. But there's a problem with that. The talent is not cheap. There are a lot of extraneous factors taken into account. And oftentimes, you know, this is just data exhaust for all these agencies. So we have this great resources, like the New York City Open Data Portal Knowledge, Andrew Nicklin, who's responsible for some of this great work. But at the end of the day, this is not something that you point your grandma to, right? Because it's basically a catalog of all data sets. Because it lacks one thing, and I think a lot of people touch on this context. How do you humanize the data so my grandma can use that data? So last year we did this thing called NYCP that we experimented a bit. So what we attempted to humanize and contextualize data basically by aggregating it on locations. On locations that people are familiar with, like neighborhoods, because nobody knows their precinct number or their, you know, tax ID number. Nobody knows those things. So we just say, okay, what's the data saying about my neighborhood? And we built a lot of maps and got data from the US Census. It was a lot of work. But at the end of the day, what we ended up with was a website. It wasn't a product. So we got a lot of feedback that, you know, a lot of cities wanted something like this for their cities. You know, because what we did was we didn't just stop with open data being published by the city. We got data from Wikipedia, from Flickr, from DNA Info, from Indeed for job listings, and contextualized all that data to location. Because one thing people touch on, and even I think Alicia touched on this, is the dirty secret of big data is a lot of it is basically just massaging data before you make that model, make that great map. So New York City, we have the benefit of the Geek Squad, you know, Andrew Nicklin, and you know, the mayor's office of the data analytics. But what about small cities? You know, I spoke to a police sergeant who doubles as the webmaster of the town website. What about them? How can they have this insights? So here's our solution. Basically, it's humanizing data, making it affordable, and basically doing a lot of these analysis in the cloud. And we call it Mediacities National. We're launching this quarter. We start with great open source technology called Zcam, called Zcam Plus. If you don't know Zcam, it's the data portal technology that powers data.gov and data.gov.uk. But we gave it map navigation. And we also preceded it with a lot of geographic boundaries, so people don't need to get a lot of this data from all these GIS portals. We do it for them. And we also preceded it with a lot of contextual demographic data from the US Census, from the Department of Labor Statistics. We pumped it in, we cleaned it up, and we give them the ability to build these dashboards without knowing R, you know, knowing JavaScript or APIs, right? So they can build dashboards on their own and publish them embedded on their CMSs. We also enabled some other great technologies on top of this open source technology with auto-tagging. We even created an app generator framework because we saw the design factor that a lot of people are creating apps based on the search engines of data. So we wanted something that works like the web, right? So allowing people to publish data the way they publish blog posts. And on top of that, we made it with an indicators platform. So you can create indicators about places. And what are indicators? These are things like people indicators, like who lives here, economic indicators, you know, what makes the economy a report here, safety indicators, housing indicators. And we did it for all 3,000 counties in the US. And all 30,000 towns and cities in the US as well. And we also allow you to build indicators you care about. So we have about 40 indicators, but you can define your own indicators if you want to, and compare them across jurisdictions. And we allow you to look at all the great data from the US Census if you want to. And who are we to build these indicators? It's not us who actually built these indicators, it's the ISO, the International Standards Organization. And we just implemented the guidance that they shared this summer. And the difference is this is not data that's sitting in a glass case. We invite people to upload their data and define their own indicators. Because ultimately what we want to do is create an answering people interface. So regular people, analysts like Casey, policymakers can have actionable information at their hands. So we're launching tomorrow, beta, and we invite you to give us, to try it out and give us your feedback. Thank you.
Interface Foundry, and much like Miriel, I have no background in mapping. I'm not a GIS person, and our goal as a company is to make things look beautiful and magical. So one of the problems that we found is that people have app fatigue. There's too much clutter in the marketplace. Currently, there's over 1 million apps, and most of them are one use. There's a 0.2% click-through. There's lots of privacy problems. For instance, now if you download Facebook Messenger, they take control of your camera, they can send text messages without your permission. And you know, it's just constant updates all the time. They always ask you to update your phone, update this, update that. And most importantly, most of this information is siloed within individual apps, which, you know, if you think about it, you might have 100 apps on your phone, but you probably only use 2 or 3 at any single point of time. So we call this problem app fatigue. And it gets even worse when you start thinking about the coming connected devices and Internet of Things wave, where every single light bulb now has its own app, every toaster has its own app, and even your thermostat at home has its own app. And you're like, just what? Why do I need an app for my refrigerator? It's just ridiculous. So our solution is this thing called data bubbles, which is information and services pinned to space and time. So as you move throughout your day, you get different kinds of interfaces and everything that you need based on who, where, and when you are. So if you think about it, you don't need to download anything anymore or update anything. Your devices just become a container that creates context-specific interfaces based on your user persona. And what do we mean by user persona? It's like at work, it basically works like the same way your Chrome browser would work. You have a little icon at the corner that shows you whether you're at your work persona or your shopping persona or you're at home. And when you're at home, it becomes like a universal remote control and it absorbs everything around you. When you're at work, you know, it could absorb like your conference schedule. If you're in an office, you know, you could get Microsoft, Adobe Creative Licenses and access to cloud systems. And when you're at a mall, you know, it can show you like shopping deals. We work on both a large GPS kind of global level as well as iBeacon level of services. I'll show you. So our system is basically a content management system for maps. We create, instead of asking people to create maps, what we do is we have templates, and these templates have like day and night to it. And then what you do is there's the global system where you put landmarks, so you drag to show, okay, this is the radius and the size of my data bubble, this is the information that I want to pin there, and this is the services that I want people to have access to based on their persona. So if you're there to work, you see something else. If you're there to have fun, you see something else. And then what we do is you can actually take a PNG, so this is actually a PNG, upload it onto a cloud map system, and we will slice and dice it and turn it into a tile map. So it's a local map over a cloud map. And we do this automatically so that even your grandmother could do it. You really just click the upload button. There's like, and it's so simple that you could draw it on a piece of paper, like on a napkin, take your photo from your pocket, take an Instagram photo, and then just click and upload it to like Google Maps, Mapbox, or CartoDB. Because most people are lazy and they don't want to create their own landmarks, what we've done is we've started partnering with different platforms, and we create automatic data bubbles using various APIs. And so when an event is created on any of our partner platforms, it creates a data bubble along with things like chat and what other widgets that we want. We inform the organizer about the data bubble, and then they claim it, and then it's just there. So it's the company is me. I'm Rachel. I'm the CEO. And then there's JR, who did tide pools and worked for OpenITP, and then Ross. And then we actually have launched the website. This is we're hiring, so please email me if you're interested in joining our team. And the website to try out our platform is bubbl.li. There's no internet in this room, so you can't test it. But once you go upstairs one floor, you could. If you have any questions, please look for me. Thank you.
Web development company, and we started out focusing on developing e-commerce applications, and we still do that, and that's a large part of what we do. But then about 5 years ago, we got involved in the Liquid Galaxy open source project, and I don't know how many of you have heard of it, but to give you a little bit of history on it, it started at Google. There was a Google engineer who still works there. His name is Jason Holt, and he, on his 20% time, he wanted to see how Google Earth would work on multiple screens, each powered by its own computer, and how would we sync that. And Jason's very smart, so he figured it out. And he started taking the Liquid Galaxy, which is essentially a multi-screen display platform, to trade shows and Google-related events. So it got to be a pretty big deal for them, but they wanted to work with a development company that wanted to, you know, extend its functionality. So that's where we came into play, and we've been working on it for the past 5 years, and it's gone way beyond the original idea of it. So we still do a lot of work with Google, and we display Google Earth, 3D objects on top of Earth, Google Street View, and panoramic content, videos and photos. So essentially, it's, and I really wish we could have brought the whole thing here, but it's essentially like 7 screens. It's really huge, takes up about 12 feet. But you essentially view Google Earth on this multi-display platform. I have a couple of pictures coming up. And you can also, essentially fly to anywhere in the world. And it's the same Google Earth that you view on your desktop, but imagine it on huge screens. And big displays. And what it is a marketing and presentation tool for companies. So if you work with Google Earth, obviously it's a great great tool for you, and anyone that has geospatial content, we definitely like talking to those partners as well. So who's using it? Well, Google offices, 40 plus locations around the world. We install them for Google, and we remotely monitor them. And through Google, we've installed them at museums and aquariums. For example, the Smithsonian National Air and Space Museum, some museums in California, so just a lot of different ones, and we're constantly growing. Commercial real estate, CBRE, is one of our clients. They use it in their new lobby in their LA office as a way for brokers to get high net worth clients into the office that want to look at different locations around the world, look at some panoramic photography of their properties, as well as obviously fly to different destinations. Travel and hospitality, for example, Hilton Hotels really uses it a lot for their conferences. We do a lot of work with universities and schools. We recently installed one for an elementary school in North Carolina, I believe. So there's some pretty lucky kids. And then obviously, pretty much any companies with GIS-based data. So, let's see. So GIS data can be visualized in 3D directly within Google Earth. We can do, these are just a few examples, bar graphs, area heat maps, connecting lines. And the idea of Liquid Galaxy is that it's a fully immersive experience, and it's extremely engaging because it's a curved set of screens, and viewers can fly around and through the data. And it's really, really immersive. It's almost like it looks like a ride. That's what kids usually say. And that's a picture of, or that's an example of what it would look like. Those are curved screens. And if you notice, you can't really tell up on the screen, but there's a podium with a touch screen on it, and there's a space navigator, essentially like a joystick, that you would use to navigate through Google Earth. This is a map overlay. We've worked with a utility company for the past few years who've used it for their conferences. We really like working with partners. So we are, you know, first and foremost, an open source software company. We haven't, up until Liquid Galaxy, we hadn't really done work with GIS. And we're here because we want to meet people like you who do a lot of work with GIS, who understand the space. And we've recently started to work with some partners here in the U.S. and, as you can see, in South Korea and a lot of work in Europe. And the idea is just, you know, if you want to explore your world, it helps you enhance your overall brand. Street View is a really neat functionality that we recently introduced. You can showcase your locations worldwide. You know, you can embed videos. There's live streaming. There's location search functionality, and you can create buttons and stuff like that. We have a content team that essentially helps make these presentations happen. And again, the reason why we're here is because we want to talk to people like you, and we also would love to invite you to our offices. We're on 23rd and Park to actually see the Liquid Galaxy in person. And I will just show you a quick video. Hopefully it'll work. We have a YouTube channel. No, it won't work. Okay.
Very much with the same mission as GISMO. Eureka itself has chapters all over the country, except here in the New York metro area, probably partly because of GISMO. So I would like to talk a little bit about what Eureka has to offer, and then we'll end the presentation with an outlook onto some early discussions about actually joining those two organizations. So Eureka itself is an organization that consists of many different branches. There's a board of directors. I'm one of the board members. There is Eureka International, which is, in spite of its name, actually the national organization. But then there's also GIS Corps, which is a volunteer organization of GIS professionals that help in emergency situations. There's the GIS Management Institute, just newly founded, which is trying to advocate for the next higher level of certification of GIS professionals, as well as GIS programs, and on and on. Eureka International itself has an education division and an operational division. The education division then itself has components like running the the conferences, having workshops and so on. And Eureza consists of a bunch of regional chapters. I jump over the GIS Management Institutes. Eureza runs annual conferences. There's the former Eureza conference itself, now in its 52nd year. There is a CAMA conference. The conference is dedicated on just addressing or GIS in transit. And we just finished the nth Caribbean GIS conference, which is a biannual conference. We run a bunch of workshops, which are for professional continuing education. This is the first set. This is the second set of workshops, which earn you points or credits towards GIS certification. These are snapshots from the website itself. So under resources, careers, you find job postings, certification, degrees. Under publications proceedings, you find a salary survey that we conduct on an annual basis. We have the Eureza Journal, of which I am the editor. We have a Eureza library of monographs that are published through Eureza. We have an advocacy division, which is basically the lobbying arm on behalf of GIS professionals. We have Eureza chapters, and that's why I'm talking here to you. We have chapters all over the place, and I don't even have, can't continue down there because it's but we have it really all over in the United States, in Canada, internationally, and we have affiliations, which is what I will end up with talking to you about because we are looking at affiliation with GISMO. So these are affiliations right now in Australia, in central United States, in Wisconsin, and in Michigan. The idea is that if we bring Eureza and GISMO together, that GISMO could benefit from a 6,000 members strong organization, from having five professional staff who are full-time working in a central office and provide support for local chapters, financial management and legal counsel, and all the other bullet points that you see there. We have been looking into working together between GISMO and Eureza, and one option is, rather than having a competing Eureza chapter next to GISMO here in New York, that we create something like GISMO, a chapter of Eureza. We have to have the legal people and both organizations look into this to what degree we can align the mission statement and the incorporation statement within the state of New York, but this is something that we started to discuss and that I wanted to inform you about. Thank you.
One quick announcement about job opportunity.
Eric Amos from Bloomberg, and I'm sure a lot of you have heard about us. We're the largest financial service technology company in the world, but we're also hiring GIS developers doing OpenStack, like Leaflet, OpenLayers, Mapbox, etc. So any of you interested in the position of Bloomberg, come give me, and by the way, we pay very well, so for those interested. And free food, too, by the way. Thanks. That's very important.
Okay, let's give a round of applause for our first
three lightning round. Okay. All right, I also have a question. So this next talk is, there are going to be five of us presenting, and then we're going to come up here and sit, and we're going to take questions and have a discussion based on some questions, okay? First, my talk. I will stay under the lineup. All right, okay. so my name is Matt Knutzen. I was introduced, I guess, by myself earlier. So we have a great big collection of maps at the New York Public Library upstairs in the map division. I'm going to talk a little bit today about how we're sort of making our maps into data effectively. We've been scanning a lot of our historical collection for many, many years, and I'm just talking about New York City today. So for about the past 9 years, we've been digitizing pretty heavily, and we've to date built a collection of about 15,000 maps available on our digital collections page as well as on our map warping platform. So you can see a wide variety of kind of different types of maps, starting from the left, fire insurance maps, maps documenting here the early electric grid from Edison, maps documenting social conditions in the city, including things like disease, and there's the best map label in the world on this, insalubrious localities. So these maps that tie together social conditions and disease and things like that. Wonderful transportation maps, and this is a tourist map from the 1870s that shows the incredible multimodal transportation network of New York City. Historical zoning maps, this is 1927, we've got them, a whole full range of those digitized, as well as auctioneering pamphlets from all over the city. Really great, amazing stuff. So we've been scanning a lot of this stuff. And as of course we know, if we want to make this into data, we want to do something with it, we first need to georectify it. So we've built a web-based georectification tool called the Map Warper. It's a very simple slice of the GIS workflow. It's georeferencing, georectifying. So we do that, enabling our users to create these big mosaics. This is 98 sheets, elephant folio atlas from William Paris, 1852 to 1854. All the way from Battery to the 42nd Street. So we can create seamed data sets, I don't say seamless data sets, as well as these sort of digital flipbooks to enable our users to study places as they transform across time. We've also built a transcription tool for painstakingly, as you all know, pulling data off of old maps, and we've done a lot of that work ourselves. This is that same Atlas series, hand-drawn by one of our map division employees here, 66,000 polygons or so. So in the last few years, we've also been thinking, how do we get this information off of these maps in a faster way? So one of my colleagues in NYPL labs, if this is difficult to see, this is the next series of that atlas from 1857 to 1862, published over that span of those dates, pulled off by a computer vision algorithm. So we teach computers to look at these, look for polygons on maps, but we know that the computers don't do that perfectly, so we'd like to pass that information in front of people, crowdsourcing, and gaining sort of consensus over if the data is good or not. So we first ask, is it a good polygon? Is it yes, good? Is it a fix, or is it a no? We make these decisions many, many different times over many, many different eyes. And if it's a fix, then we go to this, it passes into this fix loop. We ask people to classify the colors. These are fire insurance maps which document the built environment and fire insurance based on what the building is made out of, so we ask them to classify the colors. Very, very simple task. You notice all the tasks have been broken down into these bite-sized tasks. We also ask people to label things like numbers. So today we've had about 1 million yes, no, maybe color classifications. Add these numbers and so on. So we're building up a robust data set based on this. But then what do you do with all this data? How do you make sense of it? We build a prototype historical gazetteer for, and there's a lot of sort of useful overlap with a lot of the previous talks here, and we're gonna come talking to you. How do you weave all this stuff together into some sort of cogent understanding of the historical environment, of the built environment as it's manifest on these historical documents? And we have recently submitted, and hopefully we're going to get, keep your fingers crossed, a grant from the Knight Foundation to build, to hire a spatial data developer here, and build out this thing that we're calling the New York City Space-Time Directory. Essentially to do the organizing of documentation of the built environment, both on maps, and then, you know, based on the machine-readable data that we get from the maps, organizing all of the other information, either explicitly spatial or implicitly spatial, that's about those places at different periods of time. Okay, thanks. On to the next. Chris Barnett, OGP.
Okay. Okay, hello. My name is Chris Barnett. I work at Tufts University, and I'm going to talk a little bit about the Open Geo Portal, which so the Open Geo Portal is it is a data portal for spatial data, but it's also a community built around kind of application development, metadata creation and development, and also collections development. So our community is, we're a group of geospatial professionals, librarians, developers, metadata specialists, mostly universities, and we're working together to kind of identify and implement best practices for large geospatial data collections. And for many of us, this is kind of a core part of our jobs at the universities and other institutions. It's kind of a list of some of our partners. And we've kind of been working in isolation doing these things, all of our respective institutions. But together, we can kind of pool our intellectual and, as well as monetary resources and do something interesting, hopefully. So this is a screenshot of the portal app. This is the kind of Tufts branded version. So we've designed the interface kind of for quick discovery data. It's a spatial data search combined with keyword search built on top of SOAR. And we're indexing metadata for all the spatial data holdings that we have. Kind of one of the interesting things is that we're able to federate metadata from multiple institutions, display it in the same interface, and then pull the data from each respective institution to display and download. You can get the kinds of things you expect. You can get attribute information for the data. You can display it. On the background, I have several different shoreline data sets from several different institutions. The colors are changed so that you can see where one data set ends and the next begins. It's a little easier to see here. And I don't know how easy it is to see, but there's also a historical map of Manhattan coming from the Harvard Geospatial Library. We try to do kind of nice things like if you hover on one of the feature attributes, the actual definition from the metadata is streamed in so that you can see the definition of the feature, the attribute name, so that a lot of times these can be kind of cryptic codes, but if they're explained in the metadata, you can see that in line. So and one thing that kind of makes our portal a little different is that we have a strong emphasis on metadata, which I know is everyone's favorite topic. So the thing about metadata, every single layer that we have in our portal has full FGDC or ISO metadata. The majority of it has been put together by professional catalogers. And so what this gives us is kind of a reliance on standards, gives a consistency to the data, greatly improves search, but basically what this means is that data that you get from the portal is citable, it's data that you can make an informed decision about whether or not that it's valid for your research project or for the decision that you make. Some of our other software, we have Harvester. Harvest metadata does about what you would expect it to do in most cases. You can do a harvest from another OGP node, from CSW, GeoNetwork node, web accessible folder. One thing that we do that's a little different from other harvesters is that we both allow you to submit criteria as to what fields must be filled in for this metadata to be valid for you. And we also produce a report on ingest so that you can see what metadata was actually brought over and get kind of a thumbnail of what you've actually got. Another thing that we have in the works now is a metadata toolkit. The whole idea behind it is to kind of streamline metadata creation, make it an easier process. We're looking at the standard APIs for keywords, etc. I'll skip to the other time here, so I'll skip that. So probably the most important thing that you need to know, we have about 15,000 data layers that are available in our production instance. Most of those are open and publicly available. Right now we only have a handful of institutions that are represented, but in Boston alone there are 80 universities, so you can see that you can easily grow those collections to an enormous size. And that's the most important thing. Thanks. I guess I'll kick off the .gov portion of this talk. My name is Colin Reilly. I am with the New York City Department of Information Technology and Telecommunications. And as this talk was, or this gathering was presented to me, the concept was, or the use case was, there'd be a series of data consumers paired with a group of data providers. And then the use case would be the marry the two, and then there'd be, you know, genius ideas coming out of there. It seems like from a lot of the startup presentations I've seen, there's a lot of data curating going on, there's a lot of data creation, and I think there's a lot of companies out there making sense of a lot of the data that's being published by government institutions, and I guess the next phase is curating and making more knowledge from a lot of that data that's being produced. Geospatial in New York City. And as I approached this talk, I figured, you know, instead of just me speaking for 5 minutes, I'd kind of put this together as a sort of reference material for New York City data. I'll put the talk up there, so, you know, there's a lot of links. So a useful tool for people if anybody is looking for New York City data. So we are one government agency of 50-some-odd, many of which are doing geospatial within city government. We happen to manage a lot of the enterprise geospatial data sets for the city, most of which by this point has been published on the New York City's open data portal. And so here are some of the links. This is the sort of reference aspect of this presentation. So I'm sure everyone's very much familiar with the open data portal. There's also a developer portal, which is a series of APIs that the city has published. So instead of data or data streams, there's APIs where you can access some of the city's data. And I'll go over one of the ones that published. And then there are some city agencies that don't quite have their data on the open data portal. So in the case of city planning, there's a Bites of the Big Apple data set that you can access from their website. And the Department of Transportation provides a lot of data sets and data feeds on theirs. Specific
to New York City Open Data, and Andrew Nicklin is very familiar with this, the City Council passed the local law 11 requiring city agencies, city departments to publish their data. There's a link to DoITT site giving you the details of that local legislation. There's the local law as well. And then the bottom one is the dashboard, and that's sort of the list of all the agencies and sort of the dates at which some city agencies are required to make their data sets available to the public. I think we were given until 2018 to make all machine-readable data available to the public. So these are some sources for that, both data as well as the city's plan for releasing data sets that have not been released as of yet. The Open Data Portal, it's based on the Socrata platform. I think of it as an evolutionary thing. It was put out there pretty quickly. The intention wasn't to get it perfect, get it out there quick, and refine and enhance it over time. We've made some recent enhancements. In the past, you could create your own data visualization, and then when you were searching for a data set, you'd see both official authoritative data sets with user-created views of those data sets. So now there's a way of seeing just the official data sets, improvement to the map engine and performance, and then some future enhancements. The whole platform is going to get a refresh. New user experience, very much focused on non-technical people as well as technical staff with a suite of APIs. And then the ability to do location-based queries and embed your visualizations within your own pages. I mentioned the developer portal. The one I'd like to highlight is the one in the center there. It's called the GeoClient API. Some of you may be familiar with City's Geo Support System, the geocoding mainframe-based system. We actually deployed that in the cloud and wrote a REST API to that. Just in the last year alone, we've geocoded over 32 million addresses. So it's the most popular API that City's published. So if you have data that you need to publish, that you need to geocode, that's a free resource to your at your disposal. Here's some just highlights of some of the different data sets that we have. The update frequencies, as I said, is available, so I'm not going to go through all the details here. But these are some of the foundational data sets that we have and we published. As I was going through this and I was searching through the portal, I realized if you didn't know exactly what you were looking for, it was hard to find what you didn't know you were looking for. So I wrote a blog post, which I published just recently, talks about our planimetric data sets, and it goes through each one of the individual data sets, provides a link back to the Open Data Portal, so instead of having to search and find these data sets, they're all listed there in plain English with pictures to find those a little more easily. So the link is at the bottom of this page, so if you want to check back on that one, that'll be a good resource to you. And the last thing I wanted to just talk on was OpenStreetMap. One of the things I've always thought about when we made our open data available to the public is the barrier of entry was still pretty high. You had to understand mapping, you had to understand, to some degree, GIS. Am I running out of time? Or I ran out of time. All right, so I'll do this the Evelyn Wood speed reading. So a way of making our data available to a wider audience, we worked with a company called Mapbox to input the city's addresses and buildings into the OpenStreetMap data. Database. As a result of that, we get a notification of changes to any of the addresses of the building. It's a check for us to improve our city data. And then we're working on improving the streets and bike lanes within the city. And there's a Map Time NYC meetup tomorrow at MapTime's office if anybody wants to help out in that. And with that, I'll head off to the next. Thank you.
Involved in GIS for quite a long time. The program was started in 1988. Our office is over by Plains. Our kind of area of jurisdiction, what we do is Westchester County footprint. For those of you who don't know what Westchester County is, we're just way upstate north of the George Washington Bridge. I like Colin. Our big authoritative database is the Westchester County base map. Colin does one here sitting and really under, didn't really say how much work goes into those things. But that's, we manage, we fly like Colin does every 4 years. We just finished our base map project by 18 months of the photography and the data development. We support the geospatial applications of both county government and local government. There's 43 municipalities in Westchester County. We do a lot of work. We've been an ESRI shop since day one. It works well for us. I know there's many other options now, but we've invested heavily in that technology certainly as well. I manage seven full-time GIS staff, and we've been making data available really to, as files and whatnot since the 90s, but really my kind of simple message today is we publish most of our data now as services. Little spineless plug for the website, and I you can't really see much here, and I don't have a pointer, but the bar where across the top there, there's a bunch of places where you can drive around and get things. We still do provide data as files. This is in the data warehouse. We, of course, we make data available as shape files and things like that. We also make selected data sets as well. But again, the real message here is services, and we've invested a lot in combining hundreds, probably 400 or 500 layers of data into thematic map services, and it served us really, really well. And it really exposes our data to not only it's really elevated our ability to meet with, to work with developers and third parties in a way that we really couldn't do before. It's kind of a new shift. I mean, I know Colin does, they provide some services and APIs and things like that, but it's kind of a really new space for government to be providing data like this to developers. It doesn't come without some, speed bumps and whatnot, but it's really proven to be a great jump for us, and I think that's really the core of this. As you can see here, we have about 20 different map services that are available. These sit outside. I'm not going to get into this, how the part of the configuration and whatnot, but we thematically group our data into a service, and this is the a map server URL, and I'm sorry I didn't put it, but anybody wants to follow up with me or after this, if you're a developer and interested in the Westchester County footprint, I can get you the server URL. Of course, here's the REST service endpoints, and it contains all the information that you need about the services and the data. Again, just real quick, my last slide. We're spending a lot less time in making our files and data available. Just simply as we're putting most of our work into services. It's proven to be really, really great for us. We have a wide range of physical features, cultural, locational, environmental, a lot of imagery going back, and there's many government agencies that provide historical aerial photography. We go back to 47. It's been very, very successful, reaching new audiences, which is really great with all this and all the viewers and all the software folks, the options, viewers you've seen now, all these viewers now you can use to consume web services, and it's just really exploded. Even we haven't talked too much about AutoCAD and the engineering field and things like that, but even AutoCAD now can consume map services. Easy stuff has been published. Really challenge for us and Colin and those of us in the government would probably echo. The real challenge is getting to you and to developers is really going to be the stuff in the health and human services. Because there's so many issues. It's not that we don't want to, there's just so many things that are associated. That's my URL, and I'll talk to you later.
Last lightning round talk. Andrew Nicklin.
You only have 1 minute, Andrew.
Yes.
No pressure. And third in the bracket for Dr.
Great.
All right, so
So I'm Andrew Nicklin, and in the spirit of recognizing that if you have, if you want to solve the problem, the first thing you have to do is admit it. I am not a GIS professional. However, I am the governor's representative for the state's open data initiative. And I want to kind of start by talking about something weird that I see. This may be a little bit offensive to people who are particularly spatial, and I'm sorry about that. But I feel like there's two different worlds of open data. And there's the GIS world, which has been around for a very, very long time, you know, at least 20 years now, has really done some amazing things, has really built a good data infrastructure, and has brought particularly metadata and data provenance to a real art, and to a real, actually, not to a science, that probably better way. And I think the open data movement on the other side, which is relatively new within the last 5 or 6 years, has not done that same distance. And the trade-off of those things is that I think that people who work with spatial data professionally are really good and really smart at it, but it tends to be less accessible to an average software developer, an average person who's just trying to play with things in Excel and so on. And so we have this notion of like open data is really about attributes, and by the way, it might have some spatial information in like an X1 or an address or something like that. And we have spatial data, which is really driven by shapes, but is connected with information about those shapes, like where it is, if it's a building, when it's built, that sort of stuff. So it's attributes on shape information versus shape information on attributes. And I think we're finally starting to see a merging of that stuff. And that's what sort of my file types on the bottom. This isn't really the best slide in the world, it fits together very quickly, but as file types start to develop in really a smart way, things like GeoJSON and TopoJSON, I think, are really bringing the two together in a really smart way. And what I'm hoping is that people on the open data side of the world will start to tackle the issues of metadata and provenance in a way that that information is packaged with the data in the same way that it is with shapefiles or with traditional GIS data. So part of my goal is to try and push that forwards. So I'm going to talk for 2 seconds about our resources. First is we have a geospatial clearinghouse for the state. This is operated by some very smart, nice folks up in Albany. It is, however, a little bit dusty, and we need to do some work on that. So I'm actually working with these folks at the moment, and we're going to be not necessarily revamping this site, that is in the plan, but we're also going to be delivering some of the information about the data we have here into the open data portal, which I'll get to in a second. But there are something like 600 data sets in this resource, public data sets in this resource. There's a bunch of other data sets that are not necessarily public. You have to become a member of the GIS Clearinghouse in order to do that. It's not that hard. You have to agree to a license agreement and so on. Then you get access to a bunch more stuff. But 600 data sets is a lot. And I don't find it particularly easy to find stuff on here, but that's one of the things that we want to work on. We have tons of stuff like vector data, transportation infrastructure, public libraries, civil boundaries, broadband information. We have a geocoder service for the state, which we're really excited about, and I think we probably aggregate yours into ours. So in theory, if you plug an address for anywhere in the state, including New York City, we should be able to give you back really relevant and useful information. Maybe I'm wrong about that. Well, we're working on it. We have, of course, raster maps for the entire state, ortho imagery, and a digital elevation data for the entire state as well. And that's just a start. I mean, there's tons of other stuff, emergency services, facilities, educational data, you name it, it's there. It's really, really a valuable resource. And I think we have some work ahead of us to build user experience around this to make it a little bit better and make it a little bit more discoverable for people. So the second resource that I want to talk about is data.ny.gov. And so this is the other side of the equation that we have lots of data with some geographic attributes in it. There are something like 1,000 items in our catalog at the moment. Many of them have locational information in them, so you can derive maps from them. It ranges from things like, registered attorneys in New York State to where all the food stores are. Again, many of those things have X and Y coordinates on them, so you can drop them onto a map. But the data tends to be oriented more towards people who are used to working in KML environments or in Mapbox environments or things like that, where they can just extract some JSON, where they can extract some XML and they get injected in. Anyway, really fantastic resource. I strongly encourage you to check it out, and I'm going to stop there and we can go through this. Thank you.
I'm from the open data side that Andrew refers to. And then when we launched NYCpedia last year, the first email we got was from Andrew the day after we launched it. And he said, this is what I want, slicing the data so it gets complex. So we've been doing that. Well, but one thing I also would like to see is nobody really uses site search. Everybody uses Google, right? And there's this ongoing effort where all the search engines got together, schema.org. And they have a way now to describe data catalogs and data sets. So when you type something in Google, it will pull it up much the same way when you type a movie, it will tell you the nearest movie playing where you are. I would like, you know, maybe the data providers to start doing that as well, tagging the data sets with schema.org tags. And that's what we're doing with CCAN. We're putting all the schema.org tags, because when we contextualize, we consume data, we put the bounding box and everything, and then we say here. So, you know, we use, you know, much the same way all the web builders are using SEO, maybe we should do some SEO for geospatial data.
Okay.
So I think a lot of open data providers are using Socrata, so I will certainly take that and go talk to them about it and say, you should do that.
No, I mean, it's a good idea, because you don't have to go into Socrata CCAN. You can search from Google or any search engine and see the results that you would find, right? So you're searching multiple portals as opposed to going to a portal and then searching within it. Yes, it makes perfect sense.
Great. There's another question. Two more questions.
Yes, sir. Dan, give me our transit. Years ago, we started using City Basemap and overlaid a linear reference system on where our rail assets were lined up. And back then, the discussion was, would there ever come a time where you could create a linear reference system for the streets of the city? Now that we have LiDAR down, so I understand the centimeter, this might be a lot easier to automate. But this would permit would be all the infrastructure agencies like electric, telecom, and so forth, which have accurate CAD diagrams but don't have a comparable base to line those up. A lot of those CAD drawings are simply some kind of a pipe or a tunnel or a cable, which is basically an axis with a beginning and an end point, which within the context of a given agency has a precise beginning and end point by their metric, whatever it is. You know, maybe the water main people measure a distance from the reservoir downward in thousands of feet. We might pass over that and measure it in feet going upward. If all that could be properly aligned, it would make it a lot easier to coordinate stuff in a disaster. Agencies are reluctant to sort of pool all their data in one agency. But if everybody had a common sort of graphic reference based on the linear referencing rather than much more difficult gazette, which requires a lot more accuracy. You could have people simply draw up what they needed when there was a water main break or a gas main and so forth. Has any thought been given to creating an accurate linear reference for the street center line?
No. And it's not being planned, and I don't see it happening. I mean, you know, the infrastructure is being mapped to the city's base map. It's not a matter of, you know, geo-referencing scans or CAD drawings to it. It's more registering your data to, you know, the city's planimetric base map. So there is no plan for building a linear referencing system. What I would say is, you know, with the planimetric base map, we have a curb line data set, right? And there's a lot of agencies that are interested in not just, you know, spatially locating their assets like street furniture, the Department of Transportation. They want to associate it to an ID that is representative of a specific block face. We are doing that, but we're not building a linear referencing system.
All right, it just would be easier to line up with engineering type drawing.
So I have to report that about activity or API building, even multiplying transportation or data that would be transporting to active on end would be more deep visualization, easy and much more. Would be helpful either for public user to view.
More APIs for, is that what you're saying?
Deep visualization.
Okay.
Like 3D mapping, like from New York City Department of IIT Department, talk about thermal planning, about geocoding, geocoder, as they find it. If you like geocoding, if you type, you will type automatically, the map will be zooming.
Well, we do provide a geocoding API, and with that geocoding API, you can use things like open layers or leaflet to zoom into a specific geocoded location. So we are providing that.
All right. Sure, there's other questions.
Yes. I'll take one. All right. All right. Let's say that I want to open up a service that exposes a lot of financial data to the world in there. What kind of a mapping service would you develop and expose out the world to provide features like this? So you have, you know, asset classes and stuff located within a certain block in New York City or across the entire world. I saw one mention of, I believe Joel mentioned something about ISAF, and as soon as he did that, he got a lot of additional formats and stuff on there. What would that service, what would those specs call it, and what would those service names, do you understand?
I'm not sure if I feel
like an OS type service, like an open spatial consortium to have services, specific APIs.
I'm not sure what you
Yeah, so you're, so I don't know, like maybe like the PDS cities examples come to mind, So, you're looking to take financial data and you want to report that back spatially?
Yes, we have a lot of geocoded data on the web. Let's say that we want to expose it to the rest of the world that they can just easily hook into from the geospatial context. What kind of services are people using to do that?
Well, like Open Geospatial Consortium has WOMS, WFS. A lot of those are just sort of being ignored right now. Like most are using things like GeoJSON or, you know, TopoJSON formats, but I mean, there may be a specific XML schema that I'm not familiar with in the financial sector. Maybe somebody in the audience has an answer to this question.
Yes, too nerdy of a question, sorry.
Or maybe it's just an opportunity to develop one and make it the standard.
Yeah.
I mean, you look at, like, you know, transit agencies were looking to provide information on the transit assets that they had, and Portland TriMet worked with Google to define the Google Transit feature service, right? GTFS, I think is what it's called. So, I mean, this could be a case where you said you were from Bloomberg,
yes,
and you were hiring, by the way. I think he's looking to hire someone to help define this or solve this problem here.
Do you have the financial data geospatial? Does it have an X, Y?
Yeah, we
have data. So you want to just render that data in a place
and
show,
using standard technology that people are using, not trying to build a proprietary stack.
So if you had the data, I mean, Westchester County, if I'm following it, that if you have that data that's publishable on your side, one of your developers would consume my base map to render your financial data within the Westchester County footprint.
Yeah, that would be another overlay. You mentioned on there that you stopped massaging data and started, you know, working on services.
Well, we do a lot of work with data. Which, by the way, I just sidetracked. There was some comment. Data is our most valuable asset.
As is Bloomberg's.
It is. I know. Well, in government, and we're great stewards of data. You know, we probably, Colin has a much bigger project here, but over the last 25 years, Westchester County has probably has $12 to $15 million worth of geospatial data. You know, now, I mean, it may not seem like a lot, but that's a lot for a government to manage. But that's my most valuable asset. We take it very, very seriously. And, you know, so all the, when people are I just wanted to say that because if we take that very, very, it's really good data. So anyway, you can consume one of my services and render your data within a Westchester County footprint. I know I'm oversimplifying the question, but you just go to one of my services and grab it and mash it up into whatever viewer you want and away you go. I mean, I know I'm oversimplifying it, but.
Hello. With Twitter, we are having direct access to a Twitter Firefox to do something similar. So we give access to other users to the Twitter data through CartoDB, so that they can just download all the data into CartoDB and then start doing maps with that information. And we act there like a kind of reseller, right? We enable the access to the data source, and then we have the mapping platform on top of that. So it could be something similar, like getting your data from Bloomberg, from an API, there through CartoDB, and then they could then just use it and map it in CartoDB, and then share it with anybody else, or create an app on top of that. You see, maybe that answers the question a bit more? No?
You're looking at specifically, like, if you look at the census, you need to anonymize the data. If you look at the US Census, it's compiling data and it's publishing back, it's aggregating by census tract, census district. I've seen newer providers split the world into a grid and then create sort of, you know, attribute values for those grid cells. Maybe it's, you know, the amount of, you know, cash sales, you know, and so I've seen companies that are looking at traffic patterns, spending patterns, social media within the U.S., dividing that data, aggregating it at a grill and then grid, and then selling that data back to marketing companies and things like that to do more of that location-based marketing. Seems similar to what you're trying to do.
Yeah, trying to add spatial awareness to a lot of the data sets. So remember, ours is a little bit different. We have near real-time requirements, not piles.
Twitter is a good example. That's real-time, and that's a real-time data feed, and a lot of people are doing some amazing stuff with Twitter.
But Twitter is just as simple as adding latitude and longitude, too.
But this is the first time that I remember that the New York City Data Providing Agency and the Westchester Data Providing Agency are sharing a stage. And if you guys ever met on the border of Riverdale and Yonkers to compare notes on your metadata?
I'll come to that event.
I think we have time for about one or two more questions, but then we're packing in another event here,
yeah,
which is going to be happening pretty imminently. So let's do two more questions, okay?
Huh? We've met in Albany many times.
Okay.
At Sam's Data Center.
Hi, Colin just mentioned anonymizing data, and I'm just interested in. I was in a discussion like this, and the thing was all about presenting data and concerns about security, as you know, not sharing too much data. But now that there's a lot of crowdsourcing and there's a lot more kind of data that can be linked to individuals, individual people, individual buildings, etc., I think there are challenges in terms of maintaining privacy, in terms of keeping things anonymous that you're working on now.
That was to me specifically, or anyway?
Any of you.
So I think there's two angles to that question. So the first is sort of what's going on in the private sector, and is there any kind of role for government in the regulatory space? And the answer to that is probably yes, and I think there are a lot of conversations going on both at the state and the federal level around what that looks like. I think that's still very early days. I mean, we're still hearing use cases about like people collecting license plate information and building big data and that, right? So we start to understand the problem space a little bit better from a policy point of view. I think some things will happen there. That just tends to happen more slowly than base technology, honestly. From the second point of view of government data and what we do to release it, I know we have a very specific screening process that data goes through. So we actually do release a lot of health information, but it's never about an individual. It's never about, ideally it should never be attributable back to you as a person, right? And we take very, very great pains to protect that information. We have people who are very well-versed in HIPAA and the other regulatory frameworks that exist to protect information. So we really do put a lot of effort into vetting that. And there's a trade-off to that, which is that when we do that kind of work and we release that kind of data, It tends to lose its value a little bit because you can't, you know, the more granular your data, the more effective your analysis can be and so on. And when we do that kind of aggregation and randomization, the more the value that is lost. So it's always a delicate balance between, like, you know, making it as anonymous as possible, which is not releasing a data set, versus getting something that can be useful in people's hands but still protects the privacy of individuals. I think the other thing that we're up against, and you know, we're thinking about how to create guidance around this, just for state agencies at least. Another thing that we're up against is, well, if we release data now that we think is anonymous or is well protected, will the computing infrastructure in 5 years be capable of disentangling that and revealing back information that we thought was protected? And that's a really scary prospect, and I'm not sure that we have a fantastic answer for that at this point, but we continue to watch it. I do a lot of research into things like the mosaic effect and the stories around that, and you know, we continue to think about just how we can you know, be as proactive as possible about that, about protecting information.
Great, okay, last question.
What are your thoughts about creating URIs for entities that people can refer to always? You know, I know, Andrew, you worked with Jim Hender, and people say the route to the semantic web is through the geospatial web, meaning you assign universal URIs that everybody can refer to so we can all point to the same thing, that they're talking about the same thing. Is there anything that government data publishers can do so when you provide an entity, oh, you're talking about the same building in this version of the building in 2014, which may not be here in 2015?
I think there's a tremendous amount of work to be done in that space, and that's part of what I was alluding to when I was speaking earlier about being able to put metadata, better metadata in place around data that's non-spatial. There's a lot of work to be done there. I think we need to get to a place of like understanding how data can flow between different open data platforms and who reuses it and who's the authoritative owner of it and so on. And I think that's a whole other set of challenges. And we have to solve that before we can get to the really detailed record by record, here's a fully formed, fully qualified URI for a particular resource. And I also perhaps have to challenge the need for it a little bit. And I'm, you know, I think there's value in it, but on the other hand, I think that it's probably more of an ideological value at this point than a practical one. I mean, maybe I'm confused about that, but that's my kind of gut feeling at the moment on the space.
All right, that it? I did want to just add to that. I mean, like you allude to, there is a need for having sort of institutions which can support these things in the long run. And I've been hearing a lot also about perhaps instead of everybody becoming sort of minting engines for new URIs and these new brand new authorities, that we work on, you know, concordances between many different sort of ways of naming things and publishing URIs, so that people can have their own ways of calling things and we can make sense of it all together. So, yeah, that's all we got. Okay. And we're a bit out of time, so I wanted to just let you all know that we have flyers. If you want to sign up for Gizmo, they're on the outside table. Please sign them, fill them in for us here.
Please.
And I wanted to just
so thank... we'll get in touch with you,
yes,
again.
That's right. But let's just thank all the speakers from this afternoon. It's been great. Thank you all for coming. Thanks for coming to the library. Join Gizmo. We'll see you later.